When I was in the first grade, I faced some challenges in the classroom. After an evaluation, I was diagnosed with attention deficit disorder. Now, I was recommended Ritalin as a first line of treatment, and my mom absolutely refused to have me medicated. While I think this is one of the best decisions that she made for me growing up, I was forced to adapt my brain to a world it wasn't exactly designed for. To cope, I became hypersensitive to distractions, so I could prevent myself from going near them where I would lose control. But in the early 2010s or so, when I was in graduate school, the information landscape shifted dramatically. Information content became increasingly centered on social media. Social media had adapted an infinite scroll paradigm, whereby I could scroll to the next post in the next post forever. Recommendation algorithms started to take hold and improve, taking content I interacted with, or even hovered over, and feeding more of that to me. And I began to notice that this was starting to affect my focus, my mood, and my perception of reality. And I wasn't alone. There's a growing body of research suggesting that social media in its current state is associated with poor mental health and attention deficit disorder symptoms. Now, all these issues around the modern state of social media are what I collectively call the scrolling problem. Now, I was able to quit social media for a while. But after I became self-employed post-graduation, maintaining an active online presence became essential to finding clients and, in turn, paying the bills. So like many of us who already know the negative effects of social media, quitting isn't always an option. Now, I don't want to come off like someone who's anti-technology. I embrace it in my day job as a computational biologist, where I have to make sense of very complicated data sets without getting distracted by trivial details that derail my focus. And at some point, I realized that a solution to my attention issues could be found in the very strategies that I was using in my professional life. When I have to deal with something complicated, like mathematical equations, I convert it into geometry, into shapes, into pictures, as fast as I possibly can. It's a nice little hack that seems to ease everything in my brain that would otherwise go haywire. Take this map of the immune system, for example. Each of those points is a cell in your blood. Even if I don't tell you what's here, and even if you're not a biologist, you can quickly get a feel for the number of major cell populations in your blood, these islands, and their relative frequencies. I first came across one of these maps in graduate school back in 2012, and I was immediately captivated by their ability to simplify intricate data. This fascination led me to adapt similar strategies to tackle the scrolling problem. Now, I've spent the past several years focused on the proper uses, optimizations, and limitations of these kinds of maps. But the bigger picture here is that in graduate school, through a particular new technology I was helping develop, I learned how to take complex data and convert it into geometric formats like maps that are easier to digest. So, to address the scrolling problem, I created a free and open source tool that'll hopefully serve as a foundation for what's possible in the space of visually organizing our feeds. The free and open source part is important because I think for-profit tools are incentivizing the very things that are leading to the scrolling problem today. Okay, so we're all obsessed with ChatGPT's ability to output complex text. Me too. But I'm really obsessed with the ability of these tools to turn text into meaningful spatial coordinates. As an example, with the news, my favorite news media organizations have Twitter accounts that post article titles and links as tweets. And I can take these data, feed it into a large language model, and output geometric coordinates. And so now we have a map where article titles that are similar to each other in context cluster together, categorized by color. I can browse the map instead of scrolling, with article titles popping up when I hover over them. And clicking on a point takes me directly to the tweet that has the link to the article. And all of this allows me to bypass algorithmic recommendations, giving me more control over the content that I choose to consume. Importantly, this strategy helps me manage inflammatory content. See, I use AI to flag the news articles as positive, neutral, or negative in sentiment. And if I'm in a bad mood and I only want to see positive news today, I just remove the neutral and negative news from the map entirely. See, now I'm only browsing the uplifting news. On days where I don't have the mental space to handle inflammatory content, like when I'm busy preparing for a TED Talk, this strategy is particularly valuable. So map-based visualization of the news, along with adapting a proactive mindset to curating and organizing information, has significantly improved my focus and my ability to navigate social media. Research supports the importance of well-designed visualizations for dealing with complex data, suggesting that this approach could potentially benefit a wider audience facing similar challenges. While maps have been an effective solution for me, I'm certain that there are countless other visualization tools and methods that could be equally beneficial. My journey has taught me that we all possess unique perspectives, abilities, and resources that can allow us to take on problems we may not have considered before. And by leveraging this, we can develop innovative solutions that can allow us not only to solve these kinds of problems, but really just to take on more than we thought we could, especially with respect to things like the scrolling problem. So to those of you having trouble staying focused in today's world, whether it's rooted in a childhood condition or the pervasive influence of social media, know that it is not your fault. The profit-driven digital world seems to be nudging us toward attention deficit disorder at the societal level, among other things. Maps are my coping mechanism, and I think it's part of a bigger ecology of practices and open source tools waiting to be developed that will allow us to reclaim our time, our focus, and our mental health. So let's build new tools, let's share our ideas, and let's innovate together to create a better digital world for all of us. Thank you.